All right, thank you, Tony. You can take your seat in the panel. So joining Tony for this construction and real estate development panel is Mr. Harun Pandoi, Director of Planning, if you could come up, Harun. As Director of Planning, Mr. Pandoi works closely with the Ministry of Commerce, Planning and Infrastructure to develop and oversee projects that will transform our community. Next is Mr. David Johnston. He's the President of the Cayman Contractors Association. He's also the Managing Director of Corporate Electric Limited and has been in that role since 2009, helping to grow, develop and grow that business. And Mr. Justin Howe, the Senior Vice President of Development for Dart Real Estate. Justin has overseen some of the largest and community-enriching projects in his role with Dart Real Estate, having been with the organization now for over 15 years. So moderating this panel will be Mr. Ben Mee. Ben is a communication consultant with Tower. We're delighted to have him be our moderator for this panel. He's worked in radio, television, and print media. He now uses his skills at Tower as one of Cayman's leading strategic communications agencies, and he has great journalistic skills, so we look forward to him moderating this panel discussion. Welcome, Ben.
Thank you very much, guys. There's so much for us to talk about. I think I'm going to start with Tony and just to ask a question about pricing. Mm-hmm. We hear a lot moving towards the upper levels, and you did mention the mid-market, the 300 to 500 is slowly evaporating. Where do you see things in 3 to 5 years?
Well, easy to say evaporated, but there's still lots of opportunity. So I didn't want to paint a false hope for those looking to buy. There's still lots of opportunities. The unfortunate part is that you may have to go out of town a little bit. So where, you know, the 7 Mile Beach corridor, the Governor's Harbor, the Snug Harbor area, there's very little available land left for development. So if you go out a little bit, Savannah, Bodentown, that's where I think you're going to find the best opportunities for mid-level priced homes.
Okay, and then one of the big issues that we've heard throughout the community is that of beach access. We see 7 Mile Beach, as you mentioned, getting saturated. How do we get that balance, and this is open to anybody on the panel here, with regards to giving the investors what they want with their high-value properties and ensuring that we don't have this cyclical discussion about whether the rights of access are there for Caymanians to enjoy the beach as it is there for them.
I don't know that it's a serious problem as everybody makes it to be. I mean, there's lots of beach access up and down the 7 Mile Beach corridor. You know, the rejuvenation of our public beach right now is creating wonderful space. And I don't know that even with the affluent demographic that's buying these $3, $4, and $5 million condos, I don't often hear "get off my beach." It seems to be a very casual environment, even from that person that you would think would be more of the affluent, snooty, get off my beach type.
But there are challenges, but Harun, with your department, how do you deal with this issue going forward? Have we put the necessary measures in place with the recent legislative changes?
Well, I guess there's two parts to that question. Through the planning system and mechanism, we ensure that properties zoned hotel tourism, beach resort, once they trigger a certain property, the length, sort of width of the property, they are required to provide public beach access points. You know, so hotel tourism, 200, beach resort, etc. So there is that mechanism to ensure that these rights of ways are provided. Through the planning control process, we ensure that they're properly demarcated, that in more and more of ensuring that they are either delineated so that there is no misunderstanding exactly where they're located, taking it beyond simply posting of a sign. You know, different surface treatments, fencing a separation between the remainder of the property and where the public access point is. But I think it's taking it to the larger question, it's formalizing to ensure that there's a clear understanding on both parties as to exactly what the expectations are and what each party, what the entire
while I have you on the floor, so to speak, salt cell is raised by Tony, and traffic, what can you do, your department and the other authorities do to fix that? Because we see a lot of the road is locked in on both sides by pre-existing development.
Well, this is where one of those, you know, key relationships between the Department of Planning, Central Planning Authority, and the National Roads Authority comes into play. It's critical that we get the mix right as to where development is going, that we get the mix right in terms of the zoning allocation, which triggers the amount of units, the type of development you can put out there, but ensuring that that's matched up with the infrastructure. So if we're going to allow high density development in a particular area, we need to ensure we have the infrastructure, the road infrastructure, to support that high density development. And it's critical that we match the two up, and it's sort of not a chicken and the egg scenario where people move there and then we worry, well, how do we put a road there?
Justin, are you seeing these steps being taken that I see you guys have lots of confidence in development that would lead to things being smoothly operated going down the road?
Just first of all, thanks very much for the this is a superb event that the Chamber have put on. We're grateful for the opportunity to participate, for sure. Probably remiss not to thank Mr. McTaggart for his address. It was superb. To think that the country is possibly going to get down to as low as a public debt to GDP ratio of something like 10%, perhaps, is quite incredible, and surely wants shouting from the rooftops very honestly. It gives us, to be fair, our board, our ownership, great confidence in the jurisdiction. And I think that's why other people, looking around the room, what Davenport are doing, what NCB are doing, what other people are doing, it's really great. And everybody has that confidence because of the political and fiscal stability that's there. To address your question directly, yeah, obviously we've been very active in infrastructure over the last few years. I think everybody would be grateful that come autumn, that those works will be completed. That gives us a great springboard for the future, for the future hospitality and the residential projects that we see coming ahead in the future. So yes, but it requires work and thought and consideration by everybody to get there.
Let's look at another issue of the delicate balance between the environment and development. Now, we've seen changes where the national conservation law has gone on the back burner, whereas the global mindset is to think of going green and be sustainable with the development. How do we ensure that whatever we do, developers, whether large or small, are mindful that they protect what little is left of the Cayman Islands?
I can carry on.
Sure.
We're simply stewards, aren't we, of the land for future generations. So it's obviously beholding on us to do the right thing. That's why we talk about ourselves, sustainable economic growth. Without it being sustainable, it's not going to work in the future. So we need to be respectful of the environment and consider that in every action that we take.
David, you were trying to come in on this?
Yes, actually, last year, the National Energy Policy was enacted, and we still have some challenges in pushing that mandate forward, but when some of the regulations are sorted out, and when these things, I see that as a really big movement in Canada. We all see solar, we see solar in different places, but to mandate that the country is at, in 20 years, almost totally on renewable energy is pretty incredible. And we're not even close to it yet, but the amount of money that needs to be spent over the next 20 years is sizable. And this is something that we're going to see coming, and it's not here yet. But it's going to generate a lot of work.
One of the other big issues, Tony, you mentioned it, it's been in the prior discussion, issue of beneficial ownership. You mentioned that as one of the possible challenges. Have you had, or your colleagues had, any indication from potential buyers that that is an area of concern? And if so, how do you smoothen that message to them?
Well, I personally had a transaction last week where a vendor, I think maybe prematurely, accepted an offer on a $2 million property because they were afraid that the law was going to change and things were going to be negative as it relates to them. So they panic sold. Again, I think the jury's out. It's still new. Yes, there's a bit of a fear factor. People always fear the unknown. You know, communication is key. How, you know, so far, no, I don't think we've had the, you know, the phones ringing off and emails coming into the Sereva offices to say, list my property, let's get out, or, you know, a bunch of transactions falling apart. I think it's early, but I do think it has the potential to cause us some concerns.
And how would you smoothen that out?
And how would I smoothen it out? I guess it's a good PR initiative. You know, once we know more, I don't think we know enough just yet to know that how serious these ramifications could be. I'm not jumping around your question. It's just not knowing what it could do to us in terms of how we would tackle it.
Okay. Now, I see many knowledgeable people around the room, so I don't want to hog all of the questions. So,
well, I have a mic here, so if anybody wants to ask a question,
and if they don't want to, I can continue asking. See some up front.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon. Great job, Ben, and your panel. Tony spoke about infrastructure and roads, and this question probably directed to Tony, but other members can opine as well. Of course, we need space. We're a small island. It's also going to be costly to build new roads. We're doing some roads now, but probably in the next 5 years, the current trajectory of traffic, those roads are probably going to reach their capacity. So if you're going to build new roads, Tony and the panel, to the current environment that the Honourable Minister talked about in terms of cost containment and GDP to debt ratio, etc. How are we going to pay for those roads and infrastructure? Do we impose or reimpose some sort of development impact fees to pay for those? Or do we put in place tolls? Well, it's just rhetorical questions, but maybe you can think about those. And does the panel have thoughts in regard to alternatives, low cost alternatives such as public transportation, water taxes, staggered time, staggered working hours, staggered days of driving your vehicle? Controversial, but cost, not as cost as new roads. Bermuda model, mopeds.
I think what we can do
So just keep it in. Those are some alternatives. And then the other question I have for the panel and all the members really is in regard to redevelopment. If you don't have the land to go out horizontally, do we go vertically, or do we fill land? And if we fill the land, where does the water go from the rain or the runoff? And so, do we need a long-term development plan to guide us, or do we continue to shoot in the dark? Thank you very much.
Gentlemen,
are they rhetorical questions, Barry, or are you looking for? I mean, they're all valid points, and I think you know the country's got enough collective good minds, some represented here, all represented here, but there's collective good minds on you know on this island that can sort through that. I think if you just look at the stats, the ones that were presented this morning by the Honourable Minister, the data I provided, there's activity going on. So the option is we shut it down, we do nothing, or we find a way to sustain the growth and continue moving forward. I don't know that I have all the answers. I'm happy to pass the baton, but I think it's just getting the great minds together and sorting out those issues, for sure.
Just to end your question, no, I agree. A development plan is key to ensuring that the country has a good understanding of the development, who it's developing for, where it's developing, and obviously at the end of the day, how do you pay for that? So, and that's why I'm happy to say that, you know, we have begun that process to update the 1997 development plan. And by summer, we're looking to release the first part of that, which would be the policy statement, so we can get buy-in as the goals, objectives, which then lead us down into further technical studies so that we have a rolling development plan based on planning areas. So one of the concepts, and again, it goes back to this issue of choice, which I think goes to your discussion about transportation. It's having a choice of housing, housing stock, work environment, that allows for that mix. So if you have a choice that says, well, everyone is going to live out of town, everyone's going to work in town, everyone, that's where you get the car model. But again, it's balancing and saying that consumer demand with that availability of choice. To say there's a segment of the population that wants to live in an urban, wants to live in an urban area. That's a segment of the population that's more comfortable with walking. So ensure that you've got pedestrianized areas that facilitates that. You'll always have a segment of the population that says, well, I'm more inclined to use my car. So it's taking those various choices and giving people the ability to pick a choice, pick a niche, and fulfill themselves within that niche. So we're all not sort of chasing one or being forced to adopt one type of housing or infrastructure type, which then obviously is unsustainable.
Next question, Ben. Something which hasn't been touched on yet is the question that in the UK, London in particular, and to some extent in the USA, the exchange of high-end properties has led to suspicions of money laundering, particularly with money coming in from Russia and the Chinese. And I wonder what, with the rise in high-end properties in the here in Cayman, whether the temptation to get into money laundering customers, people who are interested in money laundering might start to be a problem. I wondered how Sariba deals with that, more particularly how agents who are not part of Sariba might fall liable to introducing money launderers when they exchange properties.
Thanks for the question. I can speak from Sariba's perspective. We are very, very, very regulated. I'm told in the old days, people would fly in their jets with suitcases full of money and say, I want to buy a condo, and you would take the suitcase and you would give them the keys. Today, I can't accept any money from you without knowing source of funds. There's such a process now that, I don't want to say it's cumbersome, but it is. We have the compliance people. Sariba has a, she's not on our payroll, but somebody that we engage that goes around to all the member companies and ensures that all our compliance is in order. We have to provide due diligence, not only on the buyer, but also on the seller. So we are very, very, very regulated, and I can tell you that we are very comfortable. Do the odd ones slip through the cracks? Possibly, but I can tell you not knowingly. As to your question about the independent, I don't know. I just know that we're regulated and we have to comply, especially with the anti-money laundering initiatives, and we do. So I think we're pretty safe.
Thanks, and I'm looking at the clock. Yeah. I realize we're going down, so I think we have one more question.
Yeah.
Higher end properties now going up to the east of Georgetown. want to try to think that cohesively would join the carbon talk, and secondly, if you rejuvenate it like the Tama Bay, is that being plugged in with a cruise ship facility? And secondly, I'm not sure if it was mentioned in the budget whether that was addressed or is being addressed as far as how financing of the port, which the government is committed to doing, will be addressed as part of the project.
I can't speak to the government and their budget and what infrastructure plans they have. What I can tell you is that there is a movement east. There's still some wonderful oceanfront land there, and there is nothing left on Seven Mile Beach, and almost nothing left in South Sound. So you have no choice but to keep moving. The other thing, we have nothing left in West Bay, where if you used to drive, again, not into the, for example, shores, but all along the West Bay beach side or ocean side, those lots are now being bought up, people wanting to live. So we have no choice but to push east. How we support that growth, I think that's, again, for the collective minds here to sort out, but it's definitely moving that way. There's the inland parcels that are good for affordable mid-level homes, and then the oceanfront properties is giving us that segment that Seven Mile Beach no longer provides for those that want to be on the water but can't spend $4 or $5 million. So I don't know if I answered it all. I can't unfortunately address the infrastructure, but leave that to the honorable minister if he has.
I think it's just the cohesiveness of the two.
Yeah. Yeah, they are and they aren't. It's not like you have a very affluent demographic on Seven Mile Beach and a poor pauper on kind of the East Coast. There's people that prefer that kind of East part because it's quieter, it doesn't have the hustle and bustle, it doesn't have all the activity, and they prefer that. And if you take a drive, you'll see some of the properties or the homes that are being built now are spectacular. They're mini hotels. So I don't know that there's actually a break there. The people that are living inland in the Savannahs, the Bodentown Center, many of them are driving in. Their kids go to school. They shop there. And many people just choose to live there. Whether it's more affordable or not, it's just a choice they make. But I don't see a true a breakdown.
Gentlemen, we could keep this discussion going so much longer, but we have other discussions coming up. I'd like to thank the gentlemen on the panel and thank you for your questions.